I actually forgot to film the campground and the office, but it's quite clearly to be seen. It's a military base, basically, and we just asked one of the soldiers standing in front of it where the hunting headquarter is, and they will just fetch the person who's responsible for it. And if you don't want to get the permit, you just walk on the other side of the valley, I guess. Or don't go to Doppertown at all. And if you see this old airport and the community lodge on there, that's actually a hotel and restaurant. He told us 200 per room or per person per night, and 200 for Dal Bath. The community lodge next to the old airport has good prices. You get breakfast stuff like potato, paratua, whatever that is. Maybe something like typical Alu stuff is like 40, butter toast is 50, omelette with chips 60, potato chips 40. Or we could also take potato chips as well. Noodles 80, like Chauvin, whatever to pronounce it. And Dal Bath 200. And so it's actually the best option to go here. They seem to have fixed prices as well. Yeah, you can tell him. How are the French fries?
I didn't try them. Hot. Good.
They are orange, tastes a bit different than normal, but definitely very tasty.
Yep.
Something to go for. Airport and the lodge. We got checked after you go up the hill, but they only check your passport. Maybe because I also had the permits just next to the passport copies. He has seen them, but he actually did not check them. Only writing down your name. Nobody knows if he knows about permits here in the check post. Usually the riverbeds always look quite empty, but I guess quite often actually the water just runs below the surface. It was the same as we came up from to Doppertown or down. There was also water coming only onto the walkway. I guess if you would have ducked further up, you would also find water. Maybe that's a shunt. As we have been down there, 50 meters below, around the rock, we thought if we go now left, instead of following the way to the right to go a tree angle, we thought, okay, we go left, and then we go up there where the meadow is at the forest starts, is the path. And it looked like, oh, that's the path we want to go to, and we are clever taking a shortcut. Actually, it wasn't just a 50 meters distance to a 100 meter distance to go left. It was actually more 500 meters distance, and we actually go left on the rock. So the shortcut turned out to go up 100 meters and down 50 meters again to join the path. The option would have been to go straight up 100 meters on difficult, steeper terrain, or following the walkway we actually found there, leading in a good direction, but definitely not back onto the main track we want to go. So we were saying, okay, we have been stupid. Better return now than doing it even worse and having to go back later if the other track might finish at some pasture or spring or whatever it leads to. In the corner of the triangle we run to this farmhouse, and the farmer told us going left round it. We are afraid to follow the path straight to make another shortcut, so we were actually going directly on the wall of the fence of the farm, and now we are coming up and he waits for us. Doppertown got its name from the huge patan next to it, what means flat place. And if you look on this river, that looks much more like a river coming in New Zealand, building a huge valley, than what I have seen until now in the Himalaya. It's having such a wide river, spreading river bed as well, and large, nice meadows around it. That's also maybe the reason why good horses coming from here, as there's so much space to graze them. But even so, everything looks very overgrazed and the horses look thin. But I guess it's just normal if you have community-used farmland, that it's quite likely to be overused. On the other side, I don't say that community-used farmland is bad. Like, all the fields are not community-used, the host told us. They are actually owned, and some people don't own any. Just the patch around the house, and then they have to labor on the fields of the richer ones. What doesn't make a good living, so that's why you see, even in the village, difference between the rich and the poor, and our host was one of the richer ones, having 6 large fields, as she told, and having people labor on it. In Dorpatam, we made inquiries about the trek to Dunai, and also calculated the time to go on the map, as well as looking into the Lonely Planet, and on the Food Network tracking notes we found in the internet. And we figured out it takes us around 10 days without break days to go from Dorpatam town to Dunai town. And there is food in most of the villages available. They told us at the permit office, where they also are supposed to be a tourism information center and also have a museum. And also we were buying fruit in Dorpatam. We got plenty of products, but no vegetables, just onions. The potatoes have been poor quality, so we buy them from our host, who also had old ones. And if you may look for potatoes and you don't find them, you can ask in the lodge, because they had for the French fries very good fresh potatoes there. They might sell them to you if you want them. The tomatoes have been sold out in June, like as we have been here, it's now June. And yeah, coming to the trek, we came just behind the airport. We turned 2 kilometers later right and planned to either stay in this valley you see in front of us, where should maybe water. And if there's no water, the next one you can see there's another valley coming down just before the second ridge, and we hope to find water there at least and a good campground. So this one would be the first option, but it doesn't look too good for me. It's not very beautiful, so we might go for the second one. And if there's no water, we have to go down to the main river, but I'm not sure it's accessible. Might be too steep. The first stream certainly has good water quality. It's clear, nice water, but we will still continue to the second valley, as we hope it's going to look nice and not being such a large overgrazed area, but maybe a bit more forest. So we take the risk and we might have to come back, but usually we don't go back, at least not that far, like half an hour. There's a small valley between our destination and the first one that wasn't visible from the map and from the last hill. Between the two major side streams, Elisabeth found this stream crossing our walkway just 1 kilometer before the stream or river we wanted to stay at the last option. And continuing, the land opens with larger meadows. I don't like large meadows so much as the small spots being in the forest located. So most likely we are going to search here.
Only 1 people?
2.
2 people?
Yeah.
Good. Why you are sitting? Why you are sitting? Go downside.
It's half nice
people,
here.
Too much people.
It's nice here. Nice, beautiful.
Ah, I got this one. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
But here danger. Danger.
What's that?
Here tiger.
No.
Yes.
Yeah, they are tiger, but they are not coming here.
No, come in, you know, here 2-3 cow chop, tiger. But no problem, here are people.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
In summer they don't attack human.
Ah, okay. Good, very good. Very good cooking, huh?
Just aloo.
This one aloo?
Yeah.
You like aloo?
Yes, very good.
Good.
That's the large ice stream we thought we might camp on. You can either go directly in the front, or you go on the gravel a bit further up the valley to go on the sixth head that is described in the Lonely Planet guide book. I think further up is easier. On the top of the zigzag, about around 3,700 meters, the track becomes quite narrow and follows the side of the mountain with not an extraordinary steep drop, but certainly a drop if you fall you can't hold yourself, so a certain amount of confident walking is necessary to go up here. But it's still easy for me to walk this walkway, as there's no skill needed. Just you must be used to steep drops on the left or right side of your track. Potatoes, lentils, rice, kudrun, mushroom, onion, and garlic is in there, and masala from the last homestay. There are three options for the last meters before the pass. One of them we took is just going straight through that valley. Second one is going over that grassy hill up there, all over the way there. Or what the local women did, they came down this way. This one we took and what the women took are on the map. The third one is not on the map on this map. The way we choose gets a bit narrow on gravel, so Elizabeth feels a bit too slide down. She doesn't feel that comfortable on here. Even so, it's actually not difficult to walk on that, but definitely scary. Which of the three ways would you choose next time? So this one, the new stand down there, it's the most right one, absolutely easy. As it's longer, locals use this broken stuff where actually one of the men came up and offered her to carry the backpack over the difficult area.
I guess if you have a porter, it's no problem to go there without a porter. And some parts are quite hard.
So it's also the other question, I would say if you get a bit bored of Nepal trekking on easy ground, you might split, people feel comfortable, might want to choose the difficult way just for fun, staying fit, and the other people just take the easy grassy one. Yeah, and the man I offered, he was like, oh, I don't want him, but he still offered him twice 20 rupee and he was happy to get it. Because everybody's working for money in Nepal, in Iran or in New Zealand, I wouldn't offer somebody money for carrying the backpack for 20 meters. But here it's like everybody's working for money, so I think it's just fair to offer something. There's plenty of camping area on the pass itself. Yeah, campsite or cooking shelter just 10 minutes behind Thakur, and also the water is 100 meters on the right side. Let's have a look inside. Maybe there's even a fireplace, I would expect. No, it's not. It's government built, so it's not worth.
It is very good.
But certainly cleaner than the rooms
yes.
In the guest house in Thakur. Kajam offers even helicopter landing platform, and it's supposed to have 3 lodges, but it has hardly 3 houses.
The 2 or 3 lodges of Kajam. Basic rooms, a nice kitchen, and good priced food. A bath for 300, potatoes for breakfast for 200 for 2 people.
From Kajam to Totapani, you walk down a number of muddy switchbacks. Be careful, it's quite slippery here. The Totapani, that is Nepalese for hot spring, is just on the other side where the walkway goes along, and it's a built, concrete built basang featuring something like 39 degrees, maybe 38, 40 around that. So it's very nice to lay in there, I guess. We stayed 2 days in Totapani and enjoyed the hot springs and watched the construction of the new bridge. Unfortunately, we are not the first tourists to use the bridge, as the bridge was not finished yet. The last 5 meters are missing because they are putting up the railing and safety stuff before they open the bridge officially. Even so, a local already used the bridge, just climbing over the wire for sure. Most likely Totapani behind Kajam will get a guest house or hotel down there. I'm not sure it's going to be one, but it definitely looks like it, being quite large, not featuring much farmland around it. And then on the right side you can see the Totapani, the hot spring, and behind the bushes is another one, and all around small hot streams going into the water. And yeah, for sure the new bridge is going to cross it to make it more comfortable. Down there from Totapani, and you see on the right side there's 3 large trees, and then just the junction is coming where it goes left to my cot, and to the right we are guessing is going to Dule, as our guide, Lone Planet trekking guide for Nepal, says 20 minutes after going up from the river. It's 50 minutes point for us here, and it also says goes around the hill, and the other point to go somewhere. The direction we want to go would be up on the ridge, but it doesn't say ridge, so it must be here. You will come finally up to a small platform where is a stone bench and also some plateau, and then the track finally turns right around the mountain. The track is easy, but definitely becomes steep next to the walkway. But the walkway is at least 1.5 meters wide here, but sometimes it narrows onto the small path. The village of Himla, that is located roughly 45 minutes, 1 hour behind Totapani. Himla even has a small shop where you can get cookies, instant noodles, soft drinks, and definitive rice and dal, chili and stuff like that, and maybe if you're lucky even honey, but right now they don't sell honey. First house of Guiban. We don't know how we should handle this. We are followed now for 1/2 hour behind the village where the young man lives, who, I don't know the English word, he is not full capable of his mind and body, and he follows us now, and it's very difficult because he also starts to make the same noises as the horse and cow boys do here, so it's not something you really want to have behind you all the time. And if we try to make him the sign that we go alone on, he makes the impression of getting aggressive, you need to be, let's say, you need to handle everybody the same way. At least that's the only thing I know about how to do it. And if somebody with his full mind would follow us, I would tell him, you don't want to be followed. So I try to do the same here, but it doesn't work. And he knows where we want to go, and we fear that he wants to follow us all the way up there, all the way to the last town. That would be very exhausting for us. I watched and stared at for already 20 minutes, I guess, during reading. Because Elisabeth is just posing. It's becoming more difficult. He follows us already for 400 meters up, and now he starts to block the track with sticks, I guess, with branches. I've seen how somebody was taking them off, or somebody wanted to block. Maybe. Don't touch me. You're not allowed to touch me, okay? And we know the way. Do you want to go in the front or back? There's water on 3000 meters and enough space for camping up there. He starts to throw rocks around 2 kilograms at us from up there. We have no idea what to do, how to handle this. We are on our edge about psychology. Do you know, treating as a equal, and don't know how to tell him that he should piss off, basically. He's not going to do that. Our only hope is that we get to the hotel in Dule and can check in there, and then we have a room to close it. Luckily, he was not getting aggressive yesterday.
Hört auf!
He was just throwing another stone, I guess.
Yeah.
He was going further up above us and throwing stones down from the hill, and as we didn't know how to react on the aggressive he had, we were hiding in the bush. Now he was going back the walkway, and we might just hide, I don't know, 20 minutes or something. So we get rid of him because we don't know how to handle this. As he started to throw 2 kilogram heavy stones at us, we were hiding in this bush. The only mean to protect us and also protect him. As I started to get a bit aggressive, as he was making more and more barriers on the track, and I was showing him that I don't accept that by crashing onto the branches, and that made him aggressive when he came. But the hiding was a good idea. We hope that he's now going down to the village and then comes back up and not just running a few 100 meters back. But we hear him far off, so we have the hope that we can now continue our trek undisturbed to Dule. Was the barrier, everything started with the stone throwing. No, he saw it far earlier, but that was the point. It got so bad that we had to turn. We're at the junction. Both ways look acceptable, but I guess it's more likely going to be left. It's left, that's what our GPS points say we got from the internet. I do not know the English name for this one, it's in German Rhabarber, but it's definitely one of my favorites if you cook it, putting sugar in there, and then having a vanilla sauce with it. Okay, the vanilla sauce is not going to happen here, but maybe we can convince them to cook it instead of eating it raw, and then I can put my sugar on there. That would be amazing.